So our next speaker is John Myers from the Centre of St. Martin's, and his talk is Bacon and the Cartoonist, the emergence of the figure through two opposing diagrams.
Thank you very much for the introduction, because you'll notice I neglected to put my name or anything on my opening slide. Okay, so this paper is an attempt to find points of compatibility, or at least useful comparison, between two apparently fundamentally opposed depictive practices, that of Francis Bacon, as described by Gilles Deleuze in The Logic of Sensation, and that of the cartoonist. I will begin with a short illustrated introduction that outlines the territory of this discussion, during which I will introduce comic scholar Thierry Groenstein's concept of grid. After that, I will introduce an earlier attempt to bring these two practices into relation with one another, and will use the specifics of that article to set out my own account in more detail. We will then consider comic scholar André Malocciu's concept of sequential dynamism, before returning to Groenstein's concept of gridding in order to draw out more connections between this and Bacon's diagram. I'll conclude with some brief words on my own cartoon practice. First, a quick note on terminology, because my art form is burdened with an ill-defined set of clumsy descriptors that carry unwieldy cultural and historical baggage. I make comics, which term I use as an umbrella that includes graphic novels, newspaper strips, manga, and bande dessinée. People who make these sort of artworks are cartoonists. I follow Simon O'Sullivan in using the portmanteau Deleuze-Bacon as a shorthand for the practice of Francis Bacon as described by Gilles Deleuze. On the face of it, it is difficult to imagine two depictive practices that are more distant from one another than Bacon's and the cartoonist. As Julia just reminded us, Deleuze tells us that it is a mistake to think that the painter works on an empty surface. Not only is the painter already present in the canvas, but it is crowded with what Deleuze calls figurative givens, pictorial cliches. These givens are the accumulated modes of representation and ways of seeing by which we are constantly surrounded. Deleuze-Bacon pays particular attention to photography as a constraining source of pictorial cliches. But the representational habits that are created through centuries of art history are no less of a burden to the painter. The painter's first task, then, is to remove or even to exorcise these cliches. And how is this to be done? Deleuze-Bacon says this: make random marks, throw the paint from different angles. Through these acts, which precede painting itself but belong fully to it, the artist creates what Deleuze-Bacon calls the diagram. The diagram, as employed in this particular book, differs somewhat from the fundamentally abstract notion of the diagram employed elsewhere in Deleuze's philosophy, in that, in The Logic of Sensation, Deleuze is happy to describe the diagrams operating in practices of different painters in terms of sets of material forms. In Van Gogh, for example, the diagram is identified as, quote, the set of straight and curved hatch marks that raise and lower the ground, twist the trees, and make the sky palpitate. In Bacon, it is a set of non-representative traits and color patches. These marks are not yet elements of depiction. At this stage, they are a-signifying. What they do is clear out the canvas of the cliches and givens. And secondly, they create zones of possibility on the canvas. Marks made at this diagramming stage begin to focus the painter's attention on particular areas and suggest depictive gestures that may be made there. For Deleuze-Bacon, this struggle in painting is fundamentally a struggle to avoid narrative, to avoid illustration. Depiction that exists in relation to a pre-existing referent, or that narrates a story, is what Deleuze calls the figurative. For Bacon, the task is to transcend or escape the figurative by creating not a representation that signifies through its employment of existing ways of seeing, but one that creates a sense of presence that is physically felt, but acts directly on the nervous system. The cartoonist, by contrast, is intensely concerned with narrative and illustration. Indeed, practitioners of this art form are usually pleased when they discover or invent a material form that can be used reliably to signify a character, emotion, or gesture. Rather than seeking to exorcise the clichés that crowd the drawing surface, the cartoonist's development of their own operative diagram can be seen as the creation and embrace of a set of clichés that will then be employed in the serial depictions they must create in order to produce a comic. Thierry Grodstein, in The System of Comics, gives the name Gridden to the initial pre-pictorial work that is done by the cartoonist. He describes gridding as a primary repartition of the narrative material. In this account, the narrative material is already present, is necessarily present, and the cartoonist seeks to give this form. Like the intense pre-pictorial work done by the painter, this work, as Grodstein says, is not necessarily incarnated. The very first act of gridding may be, for example, the first idea a cartoonist has about the chapters into which a long narrative may be divided. Or, at a smaller scale, gridding may consist in the decision to divide narrative material into a particular sequence of depictions. The emergence of the figure, then, does depend on the presence of figurative material. Deleuze-Bacon readily acknowledges that, of course, bodies are pictured within Bacon's paintings. The figure, though, is not wholly contained within these depictions, cannot be extracted from these picturings by a process of decoding established signifying forms. It is my contention here that in comics, the figure arises from sequence, from the multiple networked depictions that constitute the comics page. If, for example, you look at the set of six caricatures of Francis Bacon currently on screen, and imagine these six depictions not to be distinct subjects or figures, but to be multiple depictions of a single subject. And indeed, if you read the six caricatures as depicting the same subject represented in a couple of the earlier slides, then what you have in mind is an idea of human presence that arises from specific picturings, but is not contained within any one of them. While the individual images within comics overwhelmingly tend to embrace and reinforce illustration and narrative, and do so through the deliberate use of a set of figurative givens, it is in the resulting accumulation of networked images that something like the figure can emerge. By characterizing the operation of these terms in comics in this way, my account differs significantly from that offered in the only other attempt to connect Deleuze-Bacon and the cartoonist, of which I am aware. This account was provided in a 1986 article by Pierre Sturks, entitled The Magnifying Glass and the Sponge. Sturks opens his article with comments that I could very well have used to open this paper. Quote, "Theoretically, painting and comics should be mutually exclusive and completely averse to one another. The former has constantly eliminated any traces of narration from its hierarchically posed figures, and the latter is obliged to narrate as clearly and energetically as possible." However, Sturks chooses not to address serial depictions, instead arguing that the cartoonist's diagram is best observed when one examines individual panels in isolation. A key example he employs is the work of Roy Lichtenstein. He argues that by isolating and enlarging individual comics panels and turning the bending dots pattern into something approaching geometric abstraction, narrative is removed and the marks that constitute the panel in question can be seen as a collection of a-signifying traits. Within comics more specifically, Sturks highlights two panels from Hergé's album, The Secret of the Unicorn, both of which depict states of delirium, In the example above, Tintin's dog, Snowy, has become drunk after sipping some rum left lying around by Captain Haddock. In the example below, Haddock has worked himself into such a frenzy in his description of the exploits of one of his ancestors that he is perceived by Tintin as temporarily possessing eight arms. By presenting scenes that are, if taken literally, incoherent or impossible within the constraints of the narrative being presented, Sturz argues, these images escape figuration and become figures. I would argue, however, that the figure cannot emerge from a single panel, because this presents us only with the operative set of givens. The space between them is needed to allow the diagram to take its place on the surface. There has been a growing interest in abstract comics in both cartooning and comic scholarship in recent years. Andrei Milosiu, who we will turn to in a moment, has made productive use of this non-standard practice as a means of analysing modes of reading that are fundamental to the form. Being a relatively young field, comic scholarship has been intensely concerned with what we might call the definitional project. Much ink has been spilled in what is generally now recognised as the fruitless